Welcome, thank you for being here. I want to start with a couple of biographical information about Shaun. He was born and got his bachelor's degree and a master's degree as well. And he has received like a number of very prestigious awards, and his work has been collected by very important museums and institutions. So Keith Jarrett talks about how it's kind of absurd to think that music comes out of music. He said it's like thinking that babies comes out of babies, and Shaun's work is, for me, reminiscent of that idea. It's always, for me, pointing for or like to something else that is happening outside of the work itself. And another thing that is kind of like relevant for me is that it reminds me of this kind of approach that sometimes kids have to art making, where you give them like a sheet of paper and they will kind of fill out every single space of the instinct in that action. Another thing that has been very interesting for me is like the fact that he was, you know, he lives in California, he's from California, but his work doesn't look Californian, whatever that means. And also, while kind of like figuring out this talk, I was trying to engage with what would be like the tone of or the vibe, or what does this work was trying to do for me or to the viewer. And I felt there was kind of like a resistance at first, which I found very intriguing, but after a lot of kind of, you know, time watching his different work and meditating about it, I feel like his work for me is electronic. And not only the idea of electronic came to mind, but another like series of words and thoughts came to mind that I'm just gonna go through them. The idea of fragmentation, iconography, data, grid, maps, geoglyphic, lines, addition, negative space, Alexander von Humboldt, geometry, accumulation, topology, Bauhaus, Atari, Plato, the 60s, simulation, process, seismograph, two-dimensional, control, intellectual, the Midwest, glitch, vector, TV test pattern, mechanics, rationalism, analytical philosophy, precision, atheism, evidence, structuralism, efficiency, Nordic, Juan Miró, Mexico 68 Olympic Games, Lanes Wyman, Rube Goldberg machine, blueprint, Paul Klee, humbleness, attestable prediction, information, and question mark. And with that, I leave the room to Shaun. Thank you very much.
Well, that was a great introduction. I don't even feel like I need to say anything. I'll just like show the slides, answer questions. No. Well, thanks to Island Press, Lisa and Tom for having me come back. I had a great visit here a few years ago, and I think it's just a really special program. And doesn't I don't think exist in that many places. So thanks to you all, but also to Mr. and Mrs. Prensky. I can't remember both of them or all the Prenskys that are involved. Okay, so I have actually a lot to say and a lot to show. So, so it may like speed up and slow down a little bit, but I'm just going to get started. Well, that was too fast. I'll go back to them a little bit. I grew up mostly in the forests of Northern California. And several times as a young person, I came across trees in the forest that had been hit by lightning. One had been struck from the top and exploded into giant splinters that formed concentric rings radiating out from what remained of the tree. And later when I decided to make art, that life in the forest and the stories that came from living there led me to research the history of how America had created many of its core mythologies through narratives that portray European colonizers as conquerors and tamers of an empty wilderness. For a long time, I studied this history. It was important for me to learn about the historical, cultural, and religious narratives that intertwine to form a very particular kind of American mythology. I'm just going to go off script here a little bit and say that I grew up with my mom and my stepdad mostly, and my stepdad was grew up in New Jersey, went to prep schools, ended up at Haverford College, went to Yale, went to Princeton, and then dropped out pretty quickly in 1965, bought like a kilo of marijuana and drove to California. And my mom met him in a bar in the mid 70s. He was on a motorcycle. He raced motorcycles, and she was a early childhood development, outdoor education student, and later became a wilderness ranger in the National Park Service, and lived 4 days a week at the top of a mountain about 8 miles from a road, which was a dirt road. And they got married, and we moved to a town called Paradise, California, which recently burned down almost completely. We lived there for, you know, about 10 years, and my stepfather slowly became kind of a libertarian, and my mother slowly started living more and more in the wilderness. And we already kind of lived in the wilderness, but she had this job that took her farther into the wilderness. And so in a lot of ways, I kind of grew up with these two like very specific but like pretty abstract perspectives on the world that both embraced the natural order and also like really resisted society simultaneously, and they were kind of intertwined. these two very interesting but like complicated people. So and when I first started thinking about what I was going to make art about, it was kind of all those things just simultaneously. But I had no idea how to start it. So I started doing what I started saying just a minute ago in this talk, in which I just started studying the mythologies that both these parents seem to kind of embrace and reject simultaneously. So my stepfather was at one point a communist and then had become a libertarian and started buying lots of guns, for example. And my mother sort of slowly became more and more of like a pretty intense naturalist. And so I started looking at like the history of like how people like this that I lived with like would have come to this point, right? And how this country that we lived in would like form these people, because it was a pretty complicated upbringing. And so one thing that started happening was I started understanding, because my mom was also a pretty hardcore feminist, although my stepfather was constantly telling her that she needed to like make dinner for us and do the laundry. So that there was a conflict there quite a bit. So I started thinking about this chain of what I called paternal destroyers. As a high schooler in a history class in Paradise, California, that was taught by an ex-Vietnam vet football coach, a lot of these these images of paternal figures would, you know, were constantly sort of like being presented to me, and I was resistant to that, accepting that narrative. So I started looking at Washington and Daniel Boone, and first the Puritans, and then later it started shifting to the early American literature and the sort of second kind of wave of mythologizing that kind of paternal figure, so Ahab, and then later on started looking at the growth of wealth and the mythologization of people like Rockefeller, Carnegie, and then eventually Oppenheimer. I wanted to know, so why ideas like American exceptionalism and manifest destiny were not just accepted but celebrated, and why I had such an adverse feeling to that celebration. The world I lived in and the history told to me that described it was precarious and confusing. It was full of contradictions and lies, and I wanted to know why the voracious extraction, for example, of natural resources and animals and violence toward native people had around the world had come to define America as the greatest country in the world. Over the years, I started to construct a symbolic language that emerged chronologically, uncovering the development of these myths as they became more deeply ingrained within our national psyche. A national literature formed through the Puritans' projection of evil onto the New England wilderness, Indian wars, slavery, the development of hunter-trapper, mountain men archetype, the national political heroes forged in the image of this myth, religious fervor on the edges of the western frontier, the writing of Moby Dick, more Indian wars, the railroad, westward expansion, manifest destiny, 60 million buffalo slaughtered, George Custer and the final Indian Wars, the closing of the frontier, Rockefeller and the rise of industrial capitalism and mass resource extraction, Gilded Age accumulation, labor revolts, banana wars, industrial agriculture, the world wars. Oppenheimer, Hiroshima and the bomb, space flight, these expressions of conflict with nature stand out as mythically charged historical events that stimulated the construction of a lexicographical image system and its linear representation in the drawings. The project and studio practice became a historiographic investigation and simultaneously an autobiographical imagistic mapping of that research. I realize that that's like kind of abstract, but it's the only way I've been able to sort of reconcile like how this project started. I mean, really very simply, I'm trying to just reconcile like how I landed in this place at this time with these people, and how the things around me affect me, and how I feel like something's missing, and I'm trying to figure out exactly why it's missing. So after 10 years of making a chronological exploration of American trauma is what ultimately started to sort of emerge, right? That means like the history and also sort of like what's happening and what was happening in my house. I came to the story of the US construction and subsequent use of the atomic bomb. So I had a, I got a thing, in the Bay Area there's a something called the Eureka Fellowship, and it's funded by the Fleishhacker Foundation, and ultimately it ends up as a show at Berkeley Art Museum. And so for that show at Berkeley Art Museum, I made these two large drawings that show the sort of the research that I did that followed the narrative of the construction of the atomic bomb as part of UC Berkeley's history. It's that early, the development of the bomb is very much related to like what was happening at Berkeley. Oppenheimer was at Berkeley, and a lot of others who were doing the early research to make the bomb happen. Lawrence Livermore is still, Lawrence Livermore Labs, and out in the East Bay is still making bombs, basically, right? So this show followed up on that work, and I called it Skull Pile to the Sun, at the Jack Hanley Gallery in Los Angeles. And later it moved, this show moved to the Wattis Institute at CCA in California, at California College of Art. And this was a kind of culmination of this work on the atomic bomb and ultimately apocalypse, so I started thinking about. It was part of that ongoing investigation into how humans perceive our place in the natural order. And I started thinking about the sun as the energy source in this natural order, and nature as consciousness, and how we are struggling to become fully conscious. The fear of our own individual death is hard to accept, and is there time to become fully conscious? I started thinking about two or several currently manifesting apocalyptic scenarios. Two of them specifically, global climate chaos and nuclear self-destruction, seem more and more imminent. Confronting what I call this double apocalypse was a transformative process. And the work in this show is a manifestation of my personal confrontation with the apocalypse architect as an individual psychological process that seeks transformation, and as an objective examination of the ways in which we currently and historically have produced myths and ideologies influenced by our need to dominate nature as a mechanism for denying death. So the research of Oppenheimer sort of like brought a lot of these things related to like this mythologization and this idea that myth really stemming from our desire to dominate nature. It goes back to really the Puritans that denied that nature was pure and that it was fallen and evil. So they'd already, there was nothing sacred about nature to Puritans. And that's like the right a bit of the foundation of where we're coming from. And this work was an examination of this confluence of vengeance and creation that has become embedded in the American psyche and has contributed to our current confrontation with apocalyptic realities. Oppenheimer, there's a film of Oppenheimer where he's on a television show, and he is asked you know, a question about the his role making the bomb, and he he doesn't start weeping, but he's so crushed that it really stood out to me that that this one person had become sort of like emblematic as responsible for this like horrible event that was not really his decision. I mean, he made the decision to do science, but he didn't make the decision to drop the bomb. That was a political decision made by the U.S. government. Sorry, this is glitching a little bit. Wow, I've never seen this happen. Okay. There we go. All right. Sorry, my PowerPoint was very tripped out. I saw my confrontation with global and individual annihilation as necessary to expanding the project and simultaneously as a metaphor for disrupting previous methods of creativity. It was an intuitive process that became more a part of the making of the work, and the transformative navigation of my personal apocalypse was manifesting as new kinds of mark-making and images, and I started engaging in a kind of creativity as a cosmic process. So this confrontation with this particular moment in American history sort of bled into me changing the work. It had something to do with this like destructive energy. I sort of had to like figure out what to do with it, because it got it kind of got deep into me, and I wasn't actually going to say anything about this, but Lisa asked me about it. So after this project, I started smelling smoke, or towards the end of making these drawings, there was no smoke. So I asked people like upstairs if they had started smoking. I would ask my partner, like, have you been around people who are smoking a lot of cigarettes? They would all say no, and then I would start to go back to work, and I would start making these drawings, and I would start smelling smoke again. That made me sort of start to think differently and move, try to move on into a new place of work. And one thing that I did at the when this show went to the Wattis is I made this sculpture that was this bust of Oppenheimer that was controlled by this by the sun, really. So we put these solar panels on the roof, and the image of Oppenheimer would come and go depending on the power source, which was the sun. So if less sun, less Oppenheimer, and so that that black dot on his head would also shift on the television screen to sort of a gray in a white. It was controlled by a potentiometer, so the signal would slowly decay, and when the signal slowly decayed because of the battery and the less sun, the black dot would shift to sort of a gray white dot on a white background. I started thinking more about the sun as an autonomous force disentangled from American history. I met a man named Jim Marcy on the street in a neighborhood in San Francisco. He was looking at the sun through a telescope. I later like befriended him and found out that he was a tax accountant, and that he spent part of his life the busy time of year for him doing, pretty intense accounting, and then the rest of his free time he would be on the street looking at the sun and making drawings of the sun flares and the sunspots. And we got to know each other, and pretty well. I would see him on a regular basis, just on a bike ride past his house, and eventually I asked him if I could redraw an entire year of his sun recordings. So he recorded all these drawings that he was making of the sun flares in these notebooks. And he would draw a circle every morning on a graded piece of paper, and then he would do these drawings that were essentially like portraits of the sun flares and of the sun. And so I made this drawing, and it was ultimately purchased by the Museum of the Whitney Museum of American Art, and I titled it Jim Marcy's Sun Flare and Sunspot Drawings. And it was like just a great kind of amazing collaboration with Jim. I started thinking more about the sun, and for this piece, I asked friends and family to write a one-sentence memory they had of the sun, and then I painted their responses and called it We Remember the Sun. And I think I'm like probably going to not get too deep into some reading some of these texts, because I probably got to move on, because I'm like only in 2007 here. So I kept exploring this, my kind of personal historical and mythological relationship to the sun, and did a show in 2007 at the Susan Engel Gallery in New York City. And these paintings combine narratives from American history, both included and excluded from the consensus, with apocalyptic scenarios of the 21st century. Some of these apocalypses were imaginary, or religious, or mythological, and some were weather-related. This is a show from another show from Jack Hanley Gallery in 2008. I started looking at the motif of the sun in other cultures and discovered a star pattern that most likely originates in ancient Persian tiling, but also kind of mysteriously appears in early 19th century Ohio quilts. And I talked to the quilt museum, which I think is in Nebraska, about this, and they knew about it, but they also did not know why these star patterns in the background you see here emerged in Ohio in 1810. It's called the Star of Bethlehem quilt pattern, and there seemed to be a possible relationship between this star pattern's reference in Persians or Iranian Zoroastrianism and early Christianity that I got interested in. And I'm still interested in ways in which the East and the West have shared culture rather than been conflicted over that culture. They're different cultures. And this show was very much a look at that. These are pieces I made during a time I was crossing the Golden Gate Bridge on a bicycle every day, from where I could look down and see the Pacific Ocean on the surface. Under my feet, I saw these constantly shifting moray patterns, and I started incorporating these patterns into the work. So these were kind of like influenced by the sun and the water. And around this time, I started exploring abstraction and fragmenting the compositions and really kind of breaking down and pulling apart my previous work formally. So it got very controlled and very like formal. And then I thought of another text piece. This one was about describing one sentence in a moment in your life when you experience a radical change in the way you think about things. So I was starting to think about the idea of dialectics, you know, two things that oppose each other, and then in that opposition, creating something new. So for this piece, with a lot of help, we transferred all the answers that I received to the wall in the Inman Gallery in Houston, using varying weights of pencil. And that's why there's that gradient is, I think you can see, it's just the shift, the changing of pencil weights. So changing, things are changing, there's text about changing. Changing going on, shifting. So this show was like one of the first shows when the work really started to become, like, for a while anyway, purely abstract. I called this show Feeling Easy Feelings. And I had been continuing to think about this idea of dialectical processes of nature and in the universe as something different in the studio, only in order of scale. I continued to look for ways to make images by adding a step of dramatic change to the process. I was thinking a lot about unfixing and trying to make work that felt like a natural process, and I wanted to fuse my physical and mental movements in the studio that used cutting and flipping, painting and collaging fragments from one painting with references to geological, historical, cultural, and psychological movements. So sometimes I would slice a painting into uniform strips and then reorder those strips. And I would just come up with varying ways of reordering them. So I'd make the painting, and then I would cut it up and reorder it. So it was kind of doing my own dialectical process. Make the thing, negate it, then a new thing happens. It was pretty straightforward in a way. And then I would weave it sometimes. This one is like cut into strips, and then I wove the strips instead of glued them back together. Sometimes I would just kind of destroy them and pour glue on them and put glassine on top of that and pull it off. I started trying to make paintings that were like moments of equilibrium, sort of pulled from a perpetual state of adaptation. There was no future or past state that received any special reverence. We just go with what needed to happen. And I wanted the paintings to represent a kind of flux that matched the unsentimental momentum of the natural world. The paintings were provisional and imperfect and in flux. All right. I can't see the clock. My timer's all messed up because it was on for a way longer than I was been up here. And can I get a time check?
It's almost 6:40.
When do I stop? I'm just deciding whether I should talk about certain bodies of work or not, depending on. Stop at 7?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's great, yeah.
7-ish? All right. So there's a portico in Golden Gate Park, where I live, called The Portals of the Past. And my interest in this site comes from a reference in a Hitchcock movie called Vertigo. And my experience of passing by it regularly for many years on bike rides. In Vertigo and San Francisco folklore, the portals of the past are associated with the supernatural and a disruption in our understanding of the physical world. They are a place where spirits once of our world now pass back and forth between here and the unknown. So in this show called Doubled at Gallery 16 in San Francisco, I use the portals of the past as a catalyst to associate autobiographical, historical, and fictional narratives that might help me organize an impossible mapping of my position in space and time. I was asking to discuss the feeling of being out of time with time itself. This show was an acknowledgement of the inevitability of loss. I was looking at the loss of the past, the present, and the future. So just for like some context, San Francisco at this time was really changing. People that I knew mostly couldn't afford to live there anymore. So it wasn't just like gentrification, it was just like a total decimation of a population of cultural producers that really were not the sole reason why the gentrification was happening, but a big part of it, because tech wanted to live in San Francisco because it was cool, and the reason it was cool is because artists and musicians lived there and did interesting things. And obviously, there's great restaurants, but, after you eat, you want to go to a show, right? So, and that's, believe it or not, it's harder and harder to just see music in San Francisco, which is kind of shocking when you think about the history of music in the 20th century and what's come out of San Francisco.
So this, I was sad, you know, doing this show, and I was thinking about this loss. Previously, I had been interested in change and transition, but now I was grappling with actual loss. The loss of partners, friends. Yeah, I'm kind of tired right now, so like I'm having like intense waves of emotion. I'm just gonna show these paintings. I don't really think I can actually talk about this work. It's not. The funny thing is, it's not really sad looking work. Like obviously, it's just like some abstract paintings. But like thinking about this particular time is like. Okay, this is a good part. Same show. So I filled this book up as part of a way of thinking through all these this kind of loss and this fragmentation and these like change that wasn't, you know, resulting in like a new thing. It was just change and like and nothing, so it was just sort of a bummer. So I made this book, this like black book of nothing, but then I also like spent a lot of time repotting these plants and added them to the mix, that was a good thing to do because the plants really needed to be repotted. This show was for a gallery in East Hampton, New York, called Halsey McKay, and I took inspiration from discoveries I'd made about the formation of the Long Island Sound for this show. The gallery is situated 1 mile from a region of the Sound that 16,000 years ago was the site of a very large glacial meltwater waterfall. During the thawing of the last glacial maximum, the Long Island Sound filled with fresh glacial meltwater. This ancient and most likely very little seen by humans body of water is called the Glacial Lake Connecticut. So it's a lake that doesn't exist anymore, but we have a name for it, and let's think that it existed, and it was called Glacial Lake Connecticut. It's now Long Island Sound. At the eastern end of Glacial Lake Connecticut, a massive waterfall developed at a low spot on the ice dam created by the Orient Point Fisher's Island Moraine. Moraine is like what the glacier leaves behind, now known as the Race. The waterfall was nearly a mile wide and 60 feet high. The waterfall slowly yielded to erosion, and eventually Glacial Lake Connecticut drained completely. The system of stream channels that developed as Glacial Lake Connecticut drained away and as sea levels increased became the avenue for salt water to enter the Long Island Sound basin around 15,000 years ago. Ocean water entered the Long Island Sound basin through the waterfall notch. It then spread westward along the channel system about 9,000 years ago. Seawater had completely replaced the fresh water of the lakes, and the Long Island Sound was beginning to attain its present configuration. This piece on the back wall of the gallery is made up of 180 8x10-inch painted pages taken from a book called Waterfalls of the World. So I just painted everything except the waterfalls out of the book. And this is a short piece of writing that I did for the catalog. The magician scratched an image of the waterfall into a photograph he had taken of the large wooden doors that obscured his sculpture. One spring, they visited his mother, who lived halfway up a volcano. They drove to the summit road just above where the snow was cleared. The melting water burst from every crevice. There was a rushing, bubbling, and trickling sound all around. Later, he asked if she would think about Long Island with him. They began researching and discovered an ancient and monumental waterfall. They had also been thinking about magic. They agreed that although he really knew nothing about magic, he did have a feeling for it, a feeling that he had known quite a lot about in the past, but after being knocked on the head by some powdery yellow stones, had forgotten all of it. She told him to think about the waterfall. She reminded him to focus on what was behind the waterfall. The origin of water on Earth is not completely understood. It is likely that water was present during the formation of the planet and also created from internal processes and rain producing volcanic eruptions over time. It is also possible that comets and meteoroids brought water to Earth. This is a show from 2018 that I did at Inman Gallery in Houston. I started thinking more and more about the volcano and its role in the creation of life and water on the surface of the planet that we live on. I began assuming the volcano to be the Earth's original author. The 10 drawings in the show called More Love are part of a larger project and a film titled Walking the Strike of a Fissure, in which two people travel along fault lines in Iceland, Greece, and California. Their pursuit of volcanoes charts a proposition about natural phenomena and authorship and centers the volcano with its earth-shaping eruptions as the formative progenitor of human concepts like meaning and representation. The volcano, and by extension the earth, is a creative force. We are involved in these geological processes, but also distanced from them. In this work, I was pushing at the boundaries between these temporalities, the time of the human experience and the time of the shifting earth. They both have their various speeds. In each, the momentum of change lends itself to narratives of emotional process just at varying scales. That work led me to this painting that I called The History of Itself Being Made, Part 1, Score for Hephaestus's Foot. It's the first in a series of large-scale history paintings. This painting is the first in a sub-series about the history of the volcano, and specifically a meditation on Hephaestus, the Greek god of fire, volcanoes, blacksmiths, artisans, sculptors, and metallurgy. He is the child of Hera, whose bearing of Hephaestus is unique in that she achieves his birth without union. Hera rejects her son because of his deformed foot and throws him from Mount Olympus down to Earth. Eventually, Hephaestus returns to his smithy on Mount Olympus and crafts the magical tools of the gods: Hermes' winged helmet and sandals, Achilles' armor, Aphrodite's girdle, and Helios' chariot are all the work of Hephaestus. The scene does not retell the story of Hephaestus from the Iliad or Odyssey. It assumes the volcano to be the Earth's original author. It situates the volcano's creation of the Earth's surface as an original, radical, primeval act of creative and narrative agency, and presents a visual account of how the volcano's authorship has deposited, accumulated, stored, and distributed narrative through Earth's history. For Hephaestus' Foot transcribes a moment at the boundary between Hephaestus' metaphysical and physical worlds. It assumes the volcano to be the Earth's original author. Just quickly, this painting for a while was in a house, and people were deciding whether they wanted it or not. And curiously decision about whether to commit to the painting and where to position it in space became dependent upon the movement of the sun, which coincidentally parallels the story of Hephaestus' construction of Helios' golden chariot built to carry the sun through the sky from east to west. So the decision to for these potential collectors to put this particular painting in their house had to do with the movement of the sun. And the sun won out. They didn't buy the painting because there was a conflict between the sun and the painting. And Sorry, that's terrible to go back and forth like that. I'm just gonna let you read this. This is and then we're pretty close here. This is like about recent work. This quote is from Wendell Berry. So I would imagine from some of the things I've said, you could see why I was interested in this quote. But mainly for this show, I'm interested in this sentence, blind to where they were, it was inevitable that they should become the destroyers of what was there. So I got very interested in thinking about what Berry is talking about in terms of seeing and how we, anyway, how my ancestors became and were participants in a kind of way of seeing. My relatives came from Germany. They were German white people who came to Kentucky like many other Germans. And this person, Henry William Behrman, became a shopkeeper and a mason, and very followed the kind of trajectory that I was referencing earlier as this kind of mythological, you know, American exceptionalism. But I was interested in the fact that he was part of this journey that was made west along with Daniel Boone through this Cumberland Road and settled in eastern Kentucky sometime in the early 1800s. And I started thinking about if he, what he saw, did, like Wendell Berry speaks about in that sentence, I was curious to know like what my own ancestors saw and how they saw it. Did they? And so I started thinking about if he looked beyond his enclosure and preconception and desire to see what was there, and let what he saw change him. From the history I know, it appears he didn't see much differently than other white men. And so for this work, recently exhibited at the Inman Gallery in Houston, I'm imagining the things I would hope he may have seen, but most likely did not. He may not have seen them because they were hard to see, but also because he didn't think to look or ask about what there was and what there had been, other than the things he needed to know to become, as his obituary notes, one of the pioneering merchants of Newport, Kentucky. And I wondered if he knew about the tens of thousands of caves running through the Cumberland Plateau where he was living, in eastern Kentucky, or the ancient woodland and Mississippian culture cave drawings that they contained. I wonder if he knew the woodpecker at the cave mouth often indicates that more drawings are coming deeper in the caves and they will again appear at the exit point, and that they lead the viewer into and out of the underworld. Some of these things I can't have expected someone like this person to know about, but my question is more why there most likely was not a question about what more, a questions about what was there, what more could be seen. And I wonder if he saw all the different ways in which pileated woodpeckers of Kentucky made holes in trees. Across the river from where Henry lived was the great serpent mound, a snake effigy constructed by the Adena people, a pre-Columbian Native American culture more than 2,000 years ago. The mound is aligned astronomically with the solstice and equinoxes, as well as the moon cycle and possibly other astronomical bodies. It is located on the plateau of the Serpent Mound Disturbance, a 250 million year old meteorite impact crater. I wondered if Henry had ever visited or heard about the Serpent Mound, or if he ever felt the Kentucky magnetic anomaly, a mysterious and very magnetic source region within the Earth's crust beneath Kentucky and Tennessee. It seems possible that he would have noticed the vast stands of American chestnut trees that spread across Kentucky and Appalachia. And I wondered if he noticed the ghost forest that replaced the living trees when almost all of them started dying from a blight introduced from Europe. These paintings attempt to visualize and dramatize the phantasmal traces of ancestors that followed Broome's wilderness road. Did they see where they lived, or who had already been there? Or could they only project their vision as desire for the resources of the New World in the wake of their ruinous extractive history in Europe? And I wondered if we were bound to a cycle that takes from nature until it is totally depleted, and then seeks a regeneration through resource extraction and violence toward the peoples that steward those resources. And what it would take to break through those enclosures and preconceptions and desires to see where we are and recognize how to live there a long time without destroying it. Okay. 7 o'clock. Look at that. Sorry, that was a wild ride. I didn't really intend to go so far astray. But I'm done with my talk. And it's this work somehow, but it's like, you know, it's something else in a way. Formally, it's all kind of coming together, but it's based on this work, but it's based on some new things that I'm thinking about. There's a book at Washington University that by someone named Gilbert Imlay. It was an early, it's essentially like a real estate like pitch with maps and like things that you could find when you go to Kentucky and Tennessee in 1790. He also coincidentally wrote a really bizarre book called The Emigrants, with most likely actually written by his wife at the time, Mary Wollstonecraft, mother of Mary Shelley, fantastic writer and socialist, so I'm kind of trying to, it's about utopia, in the wake of the French Revolution and American Revolution. I don't have any idea how that is starting to, like, going to come into play in this work that I'm doing with Island or in the future. But but this piece, for example, is a newer piece. It's kind of in the body of that work that I showed with, because it's fairly recent. But it is sort of like in between these two spaces, thinking about another one of these people. So I've just been sort of like interested in these explorers who came through this area where my relatives were from. Oftentimes, the only thing you see on the first maps of Kentucky that are there that you would, that someone would write on a map now is Newport. And that's where these people were from. So this piece is based on one of these journals that was written by a man named Christopher Gist, who's sort of infamously known for saving George Washington twice from drowning in the Potomac River and I think the Allegheny. He was a surveyor, so a lot of these people, like George Washington sort of made his name being a surveyor. So that meant he worked for a company, and you know, a land company who didn't own any land when they got here, but sent people to survey land that belonged to, you know, native people to claim it through this thing called the Doctrine of Discovery, which is a fascinating papal writ from the 1500s that's still in use, which is kind of amazing. It basically says if you can take it, you can keep it, because God must be on your side. I mean, I'm bastardizing it a bit, but that's essentially what it means. So these people went out and they looked at land and wrote notes about it and made maps. And Christopher Gist did this. And so he's one of these people that Wendell Berry is kind of referring to, right? Schemes, greeds, but not seeing like what was there. But what he's seeing is there is written in these journals, coal, salt, different types of trees and grass, the kind of way the land looks. Is it fertile? It's not. He gets stuck in laurel thickets many times and is like, this isn't good. Don't come here. Just laurel thickets, right? So rhododendron thickets. He kills a lot of buffalo and a lot of bison and just eats their tongues. He's just eating bison and bear tongue the whole time. And it's he's also describing this like bizarre politics of the time. It's you know, the Iroquois are there, the French are there, the British are there, they're all trying to figure out what's going to happen, and everyone knows it's probably not going to be great, and it turns into the Seven Years' War, and things like that. So it's like, I was looking at it for that, but the thing that really stood out to me about this journal is this moment towards the end, after all the bear and bison tongue eating that was going on, is the death of his Carolina parakeet, and how he's there's a moment where you see like he's seeing something in a different way. He's seeing this parakeet that the Carolina parakeet was a native, you know, indigenous parakeet of North America, and painted by Audubon, the famous painting of them, like all over this cocklebur plant. Audubon goes on to talk about them, how they would swarm around, they made a lot of noise, they would like fly in these big flocks, they would eat cockleburs, and they would also start eating the fruits off these farmers' orchards. And so they started getting shot en masse. But the thing that he really like focuses on is how when they would get, you know, shot, you know, 30 or 50 of them in a flock, someone would go down, the rest, they would, the flock that survived would sort of fly away, but they would come back and they would sort of mourn their fallen bird family members. And so, you know, this thing kind of like struck me, this person writing this these journal entries of colonization, right, of really like these colonization documents, having this moment where he saw the bird for, you know, this the thing that it was, which was this like connection. For him at that moment, and then, you know, 100 years later, those birds are all gone because they were shot by European farmers who just couldn't, there wasn't room, right? There's no room. So this is not like a depiction, or like a literal depiction of that. And I mean, my work isn't really a depiction of any of this stuff, really. Like I don't know even if like any of you actually even saw what I'm talking about that much in this work. But it's like, you know, the things that I'm talking about, that sort of like the research and like the things that I'm thinking about and trying to, I'm not necessarily trying to, you know, illustrate them. They're just sort of driving the making of work that I'm sort of like surprised by a lot of the times myself. So this is like the beginning of like some of the work. So some of the work and that's coming from this is like happening at Island, but you know, there's no literal translation really necessarily. A little in some ways.
Can I just jump in and yeah. say that you should come by the print shop and see? That's the best.
Yeah.
You know, Ed is welcome to come by tomorrow or Friday while we're working.
Thanks, Sean.